Personally, I would suggest paying a server host to run your server as it would reduce the load on your computer. You'd have to run the server and Minecraft at the same time, which could affect performances for both softwares. You would want to run your own server if you don't have the money or don't want to spend money on a server host, or you are confident enough that your PC can run the server without any performance issues. There are four main types of server jars that are used: vanilla, spigot or paper, forge, and fabric. Vanilla is highly unoptimized. It is the vanilla game itself, so the mechanics are unchanged. Spigot or paper optimizes the server and is extremely effective at reducing the resources used. Allows for the use of plugins and is used for large minigame servers such as Hypixel. However, many vanilla mechanics are changed and so many farms may not work on this version. Forge is a modded server jar usually used to run modpacks on a server. Somewhat optimized but can be further improved with mods. Fabric is also a modded server jar that is the closest to the vanilla game, but also has the widest range and the most effective server performance mods. For our case, we'll be running our server with Fabric alongside some mods to help the server run better. Head over to the Minecraft website where you can download the server jar. This will be linked in the description. Click over here to start the download of the server jar. Select Keep to complete the download. Open File Explorer and confirm that you have downloaded the file. Right click, create a new folder, and name it whatever you want, and drag the jar file into the folder you just created. Create a new notepad file and name it Start. Go back to the Minecraft website and copy this command into your notepad document. Change this part over here to only server.jar. Click File, Save As, and change the .txt at the end to .bat. Delete the original .txt file. Double-click the start.bat file to run it, and the command window should open. Wait for a bit, and it should close back down again. New files has now been generated. Open the eula.txt file and change the value from false to true. Save and close the document. Before we run the start file again, we should set the seed of the world. Open the file named server.properties with Notepad or any other word editor. Scroll down and search for level seed. After the equal, put in a server seed you'd like the world to generate. Otherwise, you can leave it blank for a random one to be generated. Save and run the start.bat file once again. Once the server has ran with no errors, it is now up and running. We will first test if we're able to connect to it. Open your Minecraft and direct connect to a server. Type in 0 in the server address and click join. You should now be connected to your server. If you don't like the world you've generated, stop the server by typing stop and then enter. delete the world file, and run the server one more time to get a new randomly generated seed.
Very good. Yeah, you could kind of, use it. It's like getting good at searching. It's very abstract. Let's try to describe things in a way that's easy to change.
Right-click the start.bat file and click edit. Here we will change how much RAM we will provide for the server. Here are the XMX and XMS arguments, and following it, the amount of memory given. In most cases, XMX should always be less than XMS. Unless you know what you're doing, follow that general rule. As of version 1.16.5, running the server alone would require at least 2GB of RAM to start. With each player you plan to have, add an extra gigabyte. This is what my system finds optimal, but you should always experiment to see how much or how little RAM you can give the server. Since it's just going to be me, I'll only allocate 3GB to the server. Save and exit the file. Now right-click server properties and select edit with any word editing software. Here are the main settings you need to look out for. Game mode. Change this to either survival or creative depending on your server. Difficulty. Set this to whatever difficulty you want to play in for the server. View distance. This is the render distance of the server. It heavily affects server performance, and so the higher you have it set, the more RAM you'll have to allocate to the server. I'll be changing this to 8. You should look around the other settings and change anything else accordingly. Also keep in mind the server port, as it will be explained in a later part of the video. Save and close the file. Press the Windows button and search for CMD. Type in ipconfig and your network information will be displayed. Look towards the bottom where it says default gateway and take the IP address given and paste it to your browser and search.
Let's give it a bigger explosion.
This will take you to the settings page of your router, where you should write down your details and proceed to the configuration page. This step will be different for everyone. The main instructions are to go to the port forwarding settings and set up the port. For me, I'll have to go to forward rules, port mapping configuration. Here is how you should configure the port. 25565 is the default port set up for the server, so that's what you should enter. If it conflicts with another port, you can change it to what you want through the server config file that we went through before. Make sure that you have made your system as a host by putting the IP of your PC. Change the protocol to both TCP and UDP. If you don't have that option, setting it to only TCP should work. Apply and activate that port and it should be good to go. Now we should test if other people are able to connect. The IP for the server is your router IP appended with :25565. For my case, I will search up what is my IP on Google, take the IP shown and add :25565. For example, 12.345.67.8:25565. Give this to your friends and see if they're able to join. Having your IP address in the server IP is not always the safest option if you're going to be sharing it around to other people, especially to strangers. To get around this, we're going to be setting up a custom IP for free using the website FreeDNS. It's completely free and safe for as long as I've used it. Search up FreeDNS through Google and click the first result. Click Registry and search for a domain that is fitting for your server. Since this is free, we are not able to create our own, so we must use those that are already available. Once you found a domain, simply click on it. Here, you should either create an account or log in if you already have an account. Once in, fill in the subdomain. This is the main part of the address and is usually the name of your server. Here, I'm going to be inserting Zerog. This would make the server IP zerog.minecraftr.us. The destination should be set to your IP, and after that, complete the verification, then save. This will take some time to save and apply, and you should now have your custom IP. Next is a setting known as online mode. This can be found in the server.properties file we have gone through before. Open this with any word editor, and online mode can be found towards the bottom. In short, if you want players to only play with the official versions of Minecraft, it should be set to true. If you have players that play on a cracked client, such as the launcher and such, this should be set to false. This is also a way to keep out those who play on an illegitimate version of Minecraft from your server. Go to the Minecraft Fabric website link below. Click over here, and after that, select the download installer for the jar version. Once installed, double-click the jar file and this box should appear. Select Server from the top tab and choose the version you want for your server. Select the latest loader version, and for your install location, set the path to where you have the file of your server located. For me, it would be in Downloads and in a folder named Server. Hit Open, then Install. You would know this is successful when the screen text appears. Right-click the start.bat again and select Edit. Where it says server.jar, we should now change it to fabric-server-launch.jar, which is the name of the Fabric server. Save and close. Run the server and you should now see new files being generated. Once the server has successfully ran, you are now running a Fabric server. The main mods you should have installed on your server should be Lithium, Phosphor or Starlight, and the Fabric API. The Fabric API is simply the mod needed by the server to be able to run other mods, so this is essential. Lithium is the mod that does most of the performance boost. Both this mod and Phosphor has been explained in my Minecraft FPS boost guide, so check that out if you want to learn more about it. Starlight is a mod like Phosphor but is many times more effective. However, this mod is still in early development, so you should take caution if you are going to use it. I have this installed on my own server and so far, it has been stable and has been improving server performance. Use this mod at your own risk. The links to these mods will be in the description below. These aren't the only mods that you can install. Linked below is a GitHub page with a range of categorized mods, from quality of life mods such as better crafting, or mods that add more content if you desire to do so. To install the mod on your server, go to their respective websites and download the latest version for whichever Minecraft version you are using. Once done, simply drag the mods into the folder named Mods that has been previously generated, and you're done. You can now run the server, and the mods should have been activated. There are many places to install datapacks from. However, I find using vanillatweaks.net the easiest and most convenient website with many options to choose. Go to the website which will be linked below and click datapacks. Now all you have to do here is just select the datapacks. I suggest getting multiplayer sleep, so only one person is needed to skip the night, AFK display, to see if players are AFK, coordinates HUD, nether portal cords, double shulker shells, and anti-enderman grief. There are explanations on each data pack made by Exuma Void from the Hermitcraft server if you would like to see how the pack works. Now just hit download and you will get a compressed file with the data packs. Drag the file into the server, world, and into the datapacks folder. Right click and extract here, and the datapacks should now appear, and you can now delete the original file.